Good day, and thank you for joining CivilNet today. Our guest is joining us from Beirut via Skype. Nigol Bejian is a well-known film director. Many of us know him by his movies. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Chickpeas, The Verbs, Milk and Carnation, and A Godly Song about Daniel Varujan. Also today, one of his more recent movies, films, After This Day, and an interesting story. Nigol, thank you for joining us today.
Thank you for having me on the program.
Nigol, After This Day, I was very curious about the storyline, about the discovery of this orphanage. Could you just tell us a little bit more, a little introduction of what the movie is about?
The movie is about orphans and orphanages, specifically after World War I, and generally throughout our history. But I framed this look into this very sad and unstudied area within the frames of the Antoura orphanage. Antoura is a French college based in Lebanon for many, many years. But it was taken over by the Jamal Pasha's authority at the end of, towards the end of World War I. With the intention of housing a large number of Armenian orphans and subjecting them to Turkification. So basically, this is the general outline of the film.
So how did you come upon the subject? Because 100 years on, less and less such discoveries are being made. How did you come across it?
Well, I've been aware about the subject, but not so much Antoura, but about orphans, because I always in my mind I have this very symbolic image that the founders of the modern Armenian diaspora were largely orphans and widows, and what does that mean? How does that shape? How does that has shaped the character of us, our character, post-orphanage generations that has been going on for two, three, four generations now. But Antoura in specific, I was aware of it when Misa Kelesian, long many years ago, contacted me while I was an executive producer at Future TV. And he was looking for some help. That's how I became, that was like maybe more than 15 years ago. So basically this is it. So now in the film, of course, what's highlighted is who is an orphan, how do you define an orphan, what does orphan mean according to the Muslim laws, Islamic laws, what does it mean to change the identity of children by force based on United Nations Charter, which qualifies it as genocide, one that's without blood, without war, without killing, and how through this Antoura and the process of Turkification of these children, the first experiments of forming the new modern Turkish identity is discussed.
Well, you negotiate. You worked with two historians, one Armenian and a Turkish historian as well. And about speaking about these methods, did you find any certain methods that were used? What were the methods used?
Not really. I contacted both because they are both. During my research, I had become friends with them. I gave them both the same sort of instructions, if you want. I asked them for the same kind of ideas and provided them the same kind of documents that they had, I had, and we all shared. And it was a free and open discussion with no restrictions. And basically was two scholars on both sides of the conflicting camps, if you want, could sit down together and sort things out. But this is the senior generation. Then in the film, you have the younger generation by Nazan Maksutyan and Suzanne Meryem Rosita. Nazan is an Armenian from Istanbul, young historian who's specialized on orphanages. And Suzanne Meriem Rosita, who's half Turkish, half German, also has done lots of research on Antura. So you have the older generation of scholars, the younger generation of scholars, and then I have the children, few of them, who are still alive. The children of people who were orphaned in Antura. So you have also the inheritance of through the oral tradition, through fathers telling their sons of what they went through, and the sons who are now in their 80s telling us what they remember from their father.
So, and Nigel, there are terrible stories coming out about Antura, how the children were treated. There's also a mass grave of Armenian orphans there, right?
Yes, what happened is when the current administration, which is the original owners of the school, they wanted to build an annex. And while they were doing that, they dug for the foundation, and I found a whole pile of children's bones, you know. And having the fathers, because the school has religious administration, they knew the history of that period, which we're talking about, and they immediately I knew that it was the bones of perished Armenian children. Well, one of the things that I think the film highlights is the need, the extensive need of the research to be done in this subject and issues, because Antura is something we are aware of because of memoirs written and newspaper articles that were published, etc. But there were hundreds of other orphanages and thousands of orphans that we don't know what happened. And also, as I said, how does the psychology of an orphan shapes within these conditions and circumstances, and also not only the ones who survive, but also the ones who change their identity, their name, their religion, etc., etc. So now, today, when we're talking about Muslim Armenians coming forward in Turkey claiming their Armenian ethnicity, here we have something like this in Antura, where it was a failed process because they didn't succeed in turning the children into Turkish entities. So, you know, the film opens many, many, many subjects to be discussed.
I heard a story that when the orphanage was being closed, some of the administration was instructed to poison all of the students. Is this something you've confirmed or heard about?
Yes, actually, it's part of the film. This man, who's named Riza Bey, was the pharmacist. But of course, we should not understand pharmacists of then with today's standards. At that time, pharmacists were basically hygienists, you know. So this man was in charge of the hygiene and well-being of the orphans, and he's been mentioned in several memoirs. But only in one, this story of poisoning is mentioned. We have no proof. But you know, the orphan who had remembered this story and wrote it in his memoirs was someone who repatriated to Armenia in 1946 and was a quite clever young boy, much older than the other orphans. So his memory is much, much cleaner and clearer than the other ones because they were younger. We have tried to research in the Ottoman archives. We have not reached anything, but there is a general thought that maybe the documents related to this Antura story might be found in the military archives because it was under the administration of Cemal Pasha. So, and those archives are not reachable, so we don't know. However, the mentioning of the story of being the attempt or the orders to poison the children, which Riza Bey did not follow through, by saving the Armenian children and returning them, restoring their original Armenian names from the Turkified ones. That's why the film is called After This Day, because apparently he called each one of the children by their Turkish name. Let's say Cemal come here, what was your Armenian name? And Cemal would say Hagop, and he would say, after this day, your name is Hagop again. And on went with the children like this. So, but you know, I'm not a historian, so I don't need the document to say this story really existed or not. But I don't know why would someone imagine and create such a wonderful story about a man who was dominating and exploiting or oppressing these children. So I don't know how else to interpret this.
Another story from Honduras I've heard is that the children were made to stand and stare at the sun for hours until they lost their vision. Is this something you came across during the research?
Yes. It is largely mentioned in the Karnik Panyan's book, Goodbye Antura, now available in English. But, you know, Karnik Panyan's memoirs are extremely harsh and very, very, very much anti-Turkish, where are the other ones that I have read? They're not so harsh, but they all mention hardship, punishment, rules and regulations that were very hard to endure. There were hunger, there were death, there were suffering. Yes, it wasn't an easy life. And, you know, I must say this was not the first time Cemal Pasha had attempted to do something like this. This is something he also did right after the Adana massacres in 1909. But that was a short-lived and failed project also. The second time appears to be in Antura. And then the third time of this Turkification or creating a new Turkish ID manifests itself under Kemal Atatürk's regime. So, which is a very interesting point. As you know, maybe you have heard or are aware that there is this Turkish identity is very much being debated in Turkey now.
Nikol, I wanted to ask you, how long is your film? It's basically falls under the category of documentary, right? Or is there more to it? How long is it? And when we get to see it in Armenia?
The film is 78 minutes long. It is a documentary, but not in the classical term. It's actually my style of documentary, if you want. I don't know. I was hoping to show that the Golden Apricot Film Festival, but this year they closed the deadline very early. I wasn't able to submit it on time. And actually, one of the organizers of the festival is aware of the film being made, but I was never invited from their side either. So I hope sometime very soon, if not in the summer, perhaps in the fall, I like to bring the film to Yerevan and show that these two group of friends and see what we come up with.
Well, looking forward to seeing you and wish you best of luck with your future projects. And I hope a lot of our viewers will get to see the documentary themselves. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you. Hope to see you soon.